Hello and welcome to Game Onassis Weekly, your one-stop shop for video game news, keeping up with the biggest stories so you don't have to. I am your host, Jan Garcia, and today we're talking about updates regarding Activision Blizzard, when FIFA meets real life, and Epic Games' latest acquisition. All these stories and so much more on today's episode. And before we get into stories, I want to acknowledge two things. I don't know if these are two things. They might be the same thing. But there was an episode last week. I took that week off during the Thanksgiving break. I imagine I'll be doing something similar during those last like 2 weeks of December, maybe even the first week of January, depending. But I also have like a weird week this week where if you're listening to this on the earlier time that it comes out, like via Patreon Early Access or as soon as it drops for the public, you will notice that like it's early. It's like toward the end of the weekday. And that's because on Friday and potentially into Saturday, I'm going to be doing a subathon that is capped at 24 hours, playing Jak and Daxter, platinuming it, hanging out, celebrating. It's going to be a lot of fun, but I also imagine it's going to be fairly exhausting. And I also want to bring like my best self to that and my best self to the show. So the only way I could kind of figure out how to negotiate that would be to do the show a little bit earlier so that I'm not like exhausted, you know, building a doc and talking about these stories with y'all. And then it's going to be a similar run next week because I'm out of town like Friday in that weekend. So the TLDR of that is you can expect me to be recording on Wednesday and episodes to be dropping like Wednesday/Thursday, depending on if you're Patreon or public or whatever. It also means that stories will like kind of flow in weirdly where like I'm making this episode and I don't know what's going to happen Thursday and Friday, but this is the news up until Wednesday. And whatever the last episode is for the year should be recorded in a more normal cadence where I'm, you know, recording it on like Friday evening and then posting it over the weekend. So yeah, those are just some things to expect. Kind of a weird schedule. Thank you for bearing with me and listening to the show and watching the show and commenting and all of that good stuff. I really appreciate it. All right, let's get into the stories. There are two fairly significant updates, so I'll probably go through each of the stories and then discuss them more in total rather than debrief each one after reading it. So I'll probably go through these two pretty fast and then add a little bit of comment and contextualization. Starting with six state treasurers pressure Activision over misconduct allegations. This comes from Stephen Totillo over at Axios. The article reads, "The pressure on Activision Blizzard to make meaningful change over harassment allegations, unequal pay, and other workplace issues is intensifying as treasurers from California, Massachusetts, Illinois, Oregon, Delaware, and Nevada are calling on the company to take action. Why it matters. The game maker, which is already facing lawsuits and investigations, is now hearing from state treasurers who aren't afraid to utilize billions of dollars of investments, often through pension funds, as a way to trigger corporate change. In a November 23rd letter reported here for the first time, the treasurers asked Activision Blizzard's board of directors for a meeting to discuss your response to the challenges and investment risk exposures that face Activision. The treasurers noted that they would weigh a call to vote against the re-election of incumbent directors. That call was made earlier in November by Activision shareholder group SOC. The group said Blizzard CEO Bobby Kotick should resign and threaten to vote against members of the board next year. What they're saying. We think there needs to be sweeping changes made in the company, Illinois State Treasurer Michael Fariches told Axios. He cited accounts from the past few months involving harassment allegations and unequal pay at Activision Blizzard, as well as November Wall Street Journal investigation that said Kotick downplayed sexual misconduct allegations at the company. And then jumping down in the article to Between the Lines. The treasurers manage about $1 trillion in assets, but it's unclear how much Activision stock and therefore how much voting power they have. Fariches confirmed that Illinois has investments in Activision Blizzard and is therefore impacted by the company's plummeting stock price, but declined to say how much. The big picture. It's new for treasurers to be targeting a gaming company, but this type of action has plenty of precedent. A year ago, New York State announced plans to divest its $226 billion pension fund from fossil fuel companies. Last month, Massachusetts Goldberg said her state would use its investments to pressure companies to enact better climate policies. What's next? The treasurers want a meeting with Activision by December 20th. The company's board could point to its proposed settlement with the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission as a sign it is serious. It includes an $18 million victims fund and a commitment to EEOC oversight for the next 3 years. I look at that as a penalty, as perhaps an admission of wrongs in the past, Fariches said. But we're long-term investors, and we want to see those risks that cause the penalty addressed so they don't happen again. You can point to, hey, we paid the victims, we're making them whole. But if you're continuing a culture that creates new victims in the future, you're creating more risk for your company, he added. And I think that ending comment is so key in this story, where it's one thing to compensate and try to make it right with victims that you did have, but it's another thing to continue to create new ones. Like, I think that's such a poignant thing, and probably the biggest takeaway in terms of, I think, just ideologies that this sort of set forth. Obviously, we'll have to stay tuned and see how this develops later this month. Next, also from Axios, Activision Blizzard walkout organizer resigns. This comes from Megan Farokomesh, who writes, Jessica Gonzalez, a senior test analyst at Activision Blizzard, who has been instrumental in employees' collective action efforts, is resigning from the company. Driving the news, Gonzalez, who's been with the company for over 2 years, announced her resignation internally and via Twitter on Tuesday, noting that her last day will be December 10th. I made the decision to leave Blizzard by putting my well-being first, she wrote. I regret that I couldn't meet my colleagues under better circumstances, but I take our shared vision for diversity, equity, inclusion, and workers' rights with me and value the work that we've done during my time here, she wrote. I believe with enough education and awareness, ABK can be a great place to be. There's lots of work to do still, and I am mentally wounded from this fight. It's been a long and exhausting road for change, but it isn't over. In a message specifically addressed to CEO Bobby Kotick, Gonzalez says he had years to fix the culture. Quote, your inaction and refusal to take accountability is driving out great talent, and the products will suffer until you're removed from your position as CEO. Jumping down to the big picture, Gonzalez has been a vocal critic of Activision Blizzard's handling of its ongoing harassment and misconduct scandal, as well as an important internal advocate for change. Gonzalez spearheaded efforts for the most recent walkout and was heavily involved in the organization of the first. One employee told Axios that she gave a voice to tensions within the company. What's next? Gonzalez told Axios that organization efforts within the company are still going strong, and I will still be supporting ABK workers in organizing. The group is more than her, but she was the spark that started the explosion, one employee told Axios. This is definitely like a bittersweet moment. I mean, I think just out the gate, I'm happy for anyone who's making a decision that they think is good for them and their career and their well-being, and I certainly wouldn't blame anyone for just dipping. I think it's so challenging to be put in a position where your options are, do I stay and fight and create a better place because I believe in elements of what we're doing and the people that I'm working with, or do I just go and live a better life somewhere else because at the end of the day, it's just a company. Why spend all this time rebuilding when it's a company and not, you know, inherently you or family or anything deeper than just the place that you work? But then there's also that obligation of like the people that are going to come through after, and trying to, I think, move the culture forward, not just at the workplace, but also in the industry. I imagine this was a very difficult decision to make, but I hope that Gonzalez found, you know, solace and excitement in doing this, and that, you know, hopefully that spark continues to foster more activism, because it is true, there always are those few key people that sort of lead the charge. And again, that's what having a union like is so helpful for, these things where it's not constantly all this pressure on just one person holding everything together. Again, not that Gonzalez was holding everything together, because, you know, they've spoken about that, and peers have talked about it being a team effort in terms of this movement from workers. Hopefully things at Activision Blizzard get better. And unfortunately, this worker won't be around to see that improvement if and when it ever does happen. But at the end of the day, you got to do what's best for you. And, you know, I'm sure there's a lot of joy in that decision, too. It sucks. I'm sure it's not how they imagined things going down. But hopefully there's that feeling of levity and excitement and, you know, recovery, I think, after going through something like that. Last episode, we talked about PlayStation and Microsoft commenting on the situation Activision Blizzard internally. And now we have a similar story from the Nintendo side of things. The headline reads, Nintendo issues internal response to Activision Blizzard reports. This comes over from Imran Khan at Fanbyte. With the subhead, Nintendo of America President Doug Bowser says he finds the reports distressing and disturbing. The most recent update to the article says that Nintendo PR sent the following in response to our request for comment and clarification on what actions were taken, saying, quote, we can confirm the content of Doug Bowser's internal email to Nintendo of America staff is accurate. We have nothing further to share on this topic. And basically, the article starts out by contextualizing what's gone on the PlayStation and Xbox side of things, and saying that Fanbyte was able to get an email from a verified source. The article continues with, an email sent by Nintendo of America President Doug Bowser sent on Friday, November 19th, addresses the Activision Blizzard report. The email went out to all levels of Nintendo of America, including internal development houses like Retro Studios and the newly acquired Next Level Games. Along with all of you, I've been following the latest developments with Activision Blizzard and the ongoing reports of sexual harassment and toxicity at the company, Bowser begins. I find these accounts distressing and disturbing. They run counter to my value as well as Nintendo's beliefs, values, and policies. Bowser goes on in the letter to explain that Nintendo is committed to having an open and inclusive workplace where all are welcome. He remarks the company holds itself to this standard and expects the same from the industry and their partners. Though without detail, Bowser also says representatives at Nintendo have been in contact with Activision, have taken action, and are assessing others. It is not entirely clear what actions Bowser is referring to here or which ones they are still leaving on the table. He does, however, make mention of the ESA, a lobbying organization of which both Nintendo and Activision Blizzard are members. Bowser says Nintendo has been working with the ESA as of at least last week to strengthen stances on harassment and abuse in the workplace, and that the ESA must hold its members to the highest standard. Every company in the industry must create an environment where everyone is respected and treated as equals, and where all understand the consequences of not doing so. Again, as I sort of remarked with the other companies' responses to this, it is always good to have leadership that has the awareness of what's going on and what's on the minds of its employees and reassuring them in trying times like this. But I think it's also really notable in the sense that, now granted, you could argue that maybe we just didn't get access to emails from other situations, or rather that reporters didn't get access to those emails. But this is one of the few times where I feel like there is like a united front in conversation regarding this, and there's such ongoing coverage that really isn't letting up. So again, hopefully there continues to be a push from in and outside of the industry to fix what's going on at Activision Blizzard and foster a new and better culture there. And speaking of lawsuits, PlayStation has one of its own, again reminding us that there is no perfect place or place that will be devoid of issues and drama and lawsuits. And for this, we headed back over to Axios with Stephen Totillo. The headline reads, lawsuit against PlayStation alleges gender discrimination. A former IT security analyst at Sony PlayStation filed a lawsuit against the company in California on Monday, alleging gender discrimination and wrongful termination after speaking up, quote, about discrimination against females at the gaming giant. Why it matters. Video game companies are under increased scrutiny for their treatment of women in an industry long dominated by men. The article then nods to the situation at Activision Blizzard, as well as issues at companies like Ubisoft and Riot, as well as indies like Fulbright. Driving the news, the former IT security analyst, Emma Maggio, is seeking court approval to expand her effort into a class action on behalf of women who have worked for PlayStation in the past few years. The suit alleges violations of the United States Equal Pay Act, saying Sony discriminates against female employees, including those who are female and those who identify as female, in compensation and promotion, and subjects them to a work culture predominated by men. Majao alleges that she was ignored by a manager who only responds to men, was passed over for promotions, and was terminated this year after submitting a gender bias complaint to the company. She says other women at PlayStation struggle to get promoted at the same rate as men. Majo notes in her suit that Sony says she was terminated because of the closure of an internal department, though she says she wasn't in that department. The big picture. Scrutiny of game companies over their treatment of women has been especially intense in California, where Sony's U.S. headquarters is based. So yeah, I don't want to speculate too much on, you know, the intricacies of the details of the lawsuit, and, you know, what I think will happen in terms of that. Obviously, if what she's saying is true and they're alleging that it's a closure of a department that she was never in, that seems pretty suspicious for sure. And I think just the general feeling of not having the same opportunities and things. I mean, it's very easy to succumb to bias when you also have like a lack of diverse staff, I think. And, you know, the way Axios sort of contextualizes this speaks to what I feel about it, which is this is a longstanding issue of an industry that is heavily dominated by men. Not to mention, if you bring race into it and you kind of have like the intersectionality issue of it all, you know, the problems we see at any given company at any given time are not just the problems in those spaces, but I think representative of a lot of larger issues that run underneath games at all times. And I think it's easy to, especially as someone that's in media and making content and things, to almost not forget that, because obviously it's a big part of the job, but I think you, as a player, you're so focused on consuming and these platforms and all that, but underneath it all is a foundation that really needs some work. And I think there definitely have been improvements over time as we've like moved through history. And I think of how much easier it is for someone like me to come up versus it was like 10, 20 years ago even. But there's still so much work to be done. And I think just the existence of this lawsuit is a reminder of that. And onto the business slash acquisition side of things. Epic Games acquires Rock Band developer Harmonix. This comes from Matt Wales over at Eurogamer. And the article reads, Harmonix, the developer behind the likes of Rock Band and last year's music mixing title Fuser, has been acquired by Epic Games to, quote, create musical journeys and gameplay for Fortnite. Harmonix was founded in 1995 and began carving a rhythm action niche for itself with the 2001 release of the celebrated PS2 exclusive Frequency and its much-loved sequel Amplitude. 2005 saw the studio release Guitar Hero, arguably its most impactful game to date, etc., etc. Since then, Harmonix has continued to focus on music games, releasing the likes of Dance Central, 2016's Amplitude Revival, the VR-focused Autica, and most recently, Fuser, all of which brings us to today and the announcement of the studio's acquisition by Fortnite and Unreal Engine developer Epic Games. Quote, over the last 26 years, we have pushed ourselves to redefine how people experience and interact with music, Harmonix wrote in a post announcing the acquisition. Now we'll be working with Epic to once again challenge expectations as we bring our unique brand of musical gaming experiences to the metaverse, and we couldn't be more excited. Harmonix's announcement concludes with an FAQ confirming it will continue releasing DLC for Rock Band, will push ahead with season 25 of Rock Band Revivals, and will continue its current plans for Fuser events. Additionally, it says it won't be changing the way it supports older games, meaning the acquisition won't result in any game servers being taken offline or existing titles being removed from Steam and consoles. As for the future away from its current games, Harmonix says it will be working with Epic to create musical journeys and gameplay in Fortnite, which will presumably feed into the kind of grandiose mega-budget marketing opportunities that have seen the likes of Ariana Grande promote themselves in Fortnite using elaborate digital shows. Whether that'll be Harmonix's sole focus beyond the support of its existing titles remains to be seen, but the developer says to stay tuned for the first fruits of its partnership with Epic. And usually with stuff like this, I'm of the mind of, hey, good for that developer. I'm hoping they're making a good deal. We won't really know that until later. We'll see how it goes. And then folks always market it as, obviously, we're still like us, you know, but better. Which I think that's kind of part of how you market that kind of thing. And I think that's also probably assumed to be true by the company that's, you know, they're doing things that gives them the new creative avenue. But this is like one of the rare times that I saw such a negative response to this across the internet. And I can't say that I am, you know, a big Harmonix fan or that Harmonix has played a big role in my gaming, which I know is sort of unique in the sense that those games are massively popular. So a lot of people have played them. But this didn't hit as negatively for me. Like it kind of, I'm just like, it's fine because I don't have a big stake emotional investment in Harmonix, but I saw so many people bummed about them, the idea of them just doing Fortnite stuff. Obviously we don't know if they will continue to kind of do their own projects, if they'll solely be in Fortnite or doing stuff there. I will say Fortnite has had some really awesome musical experiences, admittedly, so I don't know, it could be cool. And obviously they want to do it because they signed it, so I'm guessing that that could be fine, but everyone kind of saw this as like the death of Harmonix, like the end of the Harmonix that we knew. So I don't know. Hopefully the next stuff they crank out is of quality and is fun, but it was kind of unfortunate how dark of a cloud this sort of cast over a lot of folks in the Harmonix community, it seems. So there's been a lot of darkness, there's been a lot of seriousness, I think, with the stories for this episode. Let's throw in something a little bit light. This one really caught my eye. This one's also from Eurogamer, Wesleyan Poole, with the headline, Liverpool star quits FIFA 22 tournament early to play real-life match, scores after just 97 seconds, does gamer celebration. What a headline. I'm just going to get into it. This story is so cool to me. And the article basically starts with that headline, so I'm just going to jump to the second paragraph, which reads, Liverpool frontman Diogo Jota spent the morning playing in a FIFA 22 international qualifier event before rushing off to make the 3 p.m. kickoff of his club's Premier League match against Southampton. It's a good thing Jota made it too. He scored after just 97 seconds and celebrated by sitting down and pretending to play FIFA. Jota, an 18-year-old French player, Yanis Liamu Agili were set to compete in an online qualification match for the FIFA 22 Global Series. Hoda's appearance in the tournament is no publicity stunt. As Eurogamer has reported, the Portuguese isn't just a world-class footballer, he's a world-class FIFA player. In February, Hoda was ranked number one in the world on the FIFA Ultimate Team Champions leaderboard after going 30-0 yet again during the weekend league, winning 30 matches without loss in FUT's most hardcore competitive mode is the kind of record the pro FIFA players shoot for. Jumping down to the article, Hoda told The Atlantic in December 2020, "Since my dad gave me my first PlayStation as a kid, it's been like another passion of mine. I always played football on it." Hoda has his own esports team. "You're forgiven for dropping the qualifier," they tweeted in response to the first goal. I just think that's an awesome story. I mean, it is so cool to see. And a lot of pro athletes do play like the popular sim of their sport. And some of them are quite good. Not usually like quite at that level good, but it's really cool to see those things kind of cross over. And the idea of this player being so passionate for the game, both in real life and virtually, and also being so good at both. Like, it's just very impressive and very fun. And the idea too of like him trying to fit in this tournament with his regular life and career, which is a very like abnormal career in the sense that not many people can be professional athletes in a given sport. It was just a real joy to sort of see that side of him, and what a good day for him in terms of the match as well. So yeah, it was just a fun one that I wanted to give a nod to. Moving on to game releases and updates. Life is Strange True Colors is coming to the Nintendo Switch eShop on December 7th, 2021. And there is a physical purchase available February 25th, 2022. So go pre-order that if you're interested in the physical version. Fantastic game, an absolute must play. One of my favorite games of the year by a lot. If you're into story stuff, please play this even if you have not liked previous Life is Strange games. I feel like this one will be different. But like for real, not like in the way everyone always says that. Like I really mean that. Go play it. It's freaking good as hell. And now on to the For the Free section. Starting with Xbox Games with Gold, we have The Escapist 2 available from the 1st to the 31st. Tropico 5 Penultimate Edition available December 16th to January 15th. Orcs Must Die December 1st to the 15th. And Insanely Twisted Shadow Planet available from the 16th to the 31st. Nothing here really exciting to me in particular, but go ahead and claim those now that they are available or once they become available. And of course, we also have the PlayStation Plus games for December, which include Godfall Challenger Edition, LEGO DC Supervillains, and Mortal Shell. None of those are particularly exciting to me, but maybe some of those speak to you. They do seem like definitely titles I've heard of, but nothing that I'm too interested in personally, but they're all available December 7th. And that does it for this week's episode. Thank you for watching over on youtube.com/GameOnnesis and listening on podcast services. And as always, a huge thank you to my patrons over on Patreon who will make this show and all the content I do possible. You too can head over to patreon.com/GameOnnesis for the rewards as low as $1 all the way up to the $25 tier. And as I alluded to before, I did drop a YouTube video as additional content to kind of, you know, pad out some of the lighter moments during the holidays. So I have my Game Awards voting and predictions. It is a rather long video as it's clipped out from my Twitch stream where I'm talking to the community about these games and what I want to win, what I think will win. So go ahead and tune in for that video. It was a lot of fun to put together. And you can watch it ahead of the Game Awards that happens next week. And as always, I will see y'all here next time. Bye.